glassware safely is an important part of chemistry lab.
An important part of working safely with chemicals is preventing contamination of the chemical reagents. We have a number of things we need to talk about in that area. But the first of them is that you never return unused chemicals to the original reagent bottle. So if you find that you have accidentally taken too much of a chemical, you have only two options. The best one would be to give the excess chemical to another student. That way the chemical doesn't go to waste. If you can't find another student who needs that chemical, then your only other option is to dispose of that chemical properly. There is no option to put it back in the reagent bottle. That way the reagent bottles don't get accidentally contaminated. Another way to prevent contamination is that you should never take equipment from your drawer, such as spatulas or droppers, and dip them into the stock reagent bottles. We will usually provide droppers for solutions with the bottle, or for solids, we'll provide labeled scoops that you should use to dispense the chemicals. Every now and then, there may be a solution that does not have a dropper built into it. If that's the case, and you need a little bit of that solution, here's what you do. You take a clean beaker from your drawer, and you pour a little bit of the reagent into that beaker. And then it's okay to use the dropper from your drawer on that particular sample, because if it turns out that that dropper is contaminated, you will have not ruined the reagent bottle, you'll have only contaminated this particular part. If you end up with solution left over after you're done, as we talked about before, the best thing would be to give it to another student. But if you can't, you should dispose of the chemical properly. Again, a reminder, you don't put it back in the reagent bottle. Tap water is not pure, and so we don't use it for our chemical experiments. Your lab stations contain squeeze bottles that contain deionized water, sometimes called distilled water, which is the only water we use in the chemical experiments. When you need to refill these squeeze bottles, or when you need a large quantity of deionized water, you need to come over to a special tap in the room. There's only one tap that dispenses deionized water, and it's this gray plastic tap. You should note where that is in your particular lab. When you do go to fill the bottle, you need to turn this handle very slowly, because the water comes out rather quickly, and if you turn it too far, you might end up with an accidental safety shower. Chemical names can sometimes be kind of confusing or intimidating, but it's really important that you take the time to read the label carefully. Many chemical names are very similar, but are actually different chemicals, such as sodium carbonate and sodium bicarbonate, or sodium nitrate and sodium nitrite. Using the wrong chemical because you didn't take the time to read the label carefully can be a real problem. Another thing that we use frequently are droppers, and if you use them incorrectly, you can contaminate the solution. The key thing in using a dropper is that you should always hold it so that the tip is lower than the bulb. If you tip it like this, the solution can accidentally roll into the bulb where it will become contaminated. Many students hold droppers like this because they're afraid that the dropper will drip if they hold them like this. If the bulb is working properly, the dropper will not drip in this position. If it does, it means that the dropper needs to be replaced. So if you find that the dropper drips when you hold it correctly, tell your instructor and he or she will get you a replacement bulb for the dropper. Another way to prevent contamination is to inspect the glassware before you use it. Other students will be using your lab station during the semester. So before you use the equipment, you ought to look at it and make sure there's no chemical residue left over in the equipment that could cause contamination. And you should also inspect the glassware for chips or cracks that might make it unsafe to use. If you find any chips or cracks in the glassware, tell your instructor and they'll replace it. Clean glassware is really important in a chemistry lab. So when you're finished with your experiment, here's how to clean it properly. After you've disposed of whatever chemical was in the glassware, the first thing you do is rinse it a few times with tap water to get the excess chemical out. There's no sense in using deionized water at this point. Sometimes you may need a little glassware cleaner. If that's the case, the glassware cleaner is labeled and it's on the pedestals. When you use it, just use a couple of drops because it's very concentrated. It's like dishwashing soap. So I put a couple of drops in the test tube, I use the test tube brush here. When you're finished doing that, you need to rinse this several times with tap water until all of the soap is gone, and then rinse it inside and out a couple of times with deionized water so that you wash away all the minerals that are present in the tap water. At this point, if it's something like a test tube, you can just put it upside down in the test tube rack to air dry. If it is something like a beaker, then you should dry it out with paper towels before you put it away. If it's something that's awkward to dry, like this Erlenmeyer flask, this would be kind of a hard thing to dry on the inside, then shake out as much deionized water as you can, and then put it away in your lab station where it will eventually air dry. And finally, remember, under no circumstances is it ever okay to put dirty glassware or glassware that has chemicals in it back into your lab station. If you get it dirty, you have to clean it up before you leave.
If you ever need to combine concentrated acids and water, it's very important that you remember the following safety rule. You must always pour the acid into the water, never the water into the acid. The reason for this rule is that if you pour the water into the acid, which is the incorrect way, the first few drops of water that hit the acid instantly turn to steam and spatter violently, spraying acid back all over you. If you pour the acid into the water, although a lot of heat is generated, it usually does not do this kind of dangerous spattering. So again, remember, always add the acid to the water. AAA, always add acid. Safe handling of chemicals includes proper disposal of them. When chemicals you use require special disposal, your lab instructions or your instructor will tell you, and we will provide disposal containers for you. If no disposal instructions have been discussed, most chemicals may be disposed of in the sink. The exceptions are items like pieces of metal or wooden splints that obviously don't dissolve in water.
If you spill any chemical, even a few crystals on the balance or the countertop, you need to clean it up immediately. Don't wait until later to do so. For a solid like this, we have some brushes on the balance. Just get yourself an empty weighing boat and use the brush to sweep up the chemical. If you're not sure how to clean up a spill, check with your instructor and he or she will tell you how to do it or help you with it. You shouldn't be embarrassed if you have a spill. It happens to everybody, but you should notify the instructor about any accident or spill you have, so that we can make sure that everything is taken care of properly. The most common laboratory accident we have is broken glass. Broken glass should never be disposed of in the trash. We have a special box in the lab for broken glass. Notice where it is. And on top of that box is a broom and dustpan. Use these to pick up the broken glass and wash your hands. And dispose of the glass in the box like this. Now, if the glass falls in the sink, then the broom and dustpan don't work, and in that case you should ask the instructor, and we have special gloves for picking the broken glass out of the sink. When you're finished disposing of the broken glass in the box, let your instructor know what piece of equipment was broken, and he or she will replace it without any charge to you. When you need to set a hot object down on the countertop, you need to protect the countertop. We have a couple of things in your lab station that will do this. They're in the top drawers. One of them is a ceramic pad, the other is a spot plate, and the back of that ceramic spot plate can be used. Either one of these is okay for hot objects. If you need to weigh the object that you've heated, you have to wait until it cools to room temperature. This usually takes at least 10 to 15 minutes to do. We never weigh hot objects on the balance, even with protection.
Occasionally, a lab experiment will call for smelling the odor of a chemical. What you don't want to do is you don't want to just stick it under your nose and take a big snort like that, because there are a lot of chemicals that can cause some real problems if you get too much of them. So what you do is you start with the tube about a foot away from your face, and with your free hand, you gently waft the fumes toward your nose. What happens that way is that if there is something very strong here, you will dilute it with air and you won't get such a sharp dose of it. Then if you can't smell anything like this, slowly bring the tube closer and closer to your face.
We've covered a lot of material in this video, so it would be a good idea to review these notes before your first few labs until the procedures become automatic to you. Now, even though you sometimes work with dangerous chemicals in a chem lab, there's no reason to be afraid of working in the lab. It's very much like driving a car. If you're not careful when you drive a car, you can hurt yourself. But if you are careful, the chances are very small that anything bad will happen. And the same is true for chem lab. If you follow the procedures that we've talked about, you will be working correctly, and more important, you will be working safely.